Okay. Before we start, just a few reminders of the program to highlight what are the objectives of ADB's Asia Leadership Program on Sustainable Development and Climate Change. This is a sort of a hallmark knowledge product of ADB, and the purposes are, one, to enhance knowledge and leadership capabilities of our client countries, to help promote knowledge sharing and learning, as well as to operationalize lessons and best practices. When this program was created, the idea was to bring together the Asian experiences and to share them more within the region as well as throughout the world. And this knowledge sharing series is one of the four features that we offer in addition to the annual program, the e-learning courses, as well as the online community of leaders. And for this series, the aim is to enhance dialogue among us as well as to promote knowledge sharing and learning. I'd like to highlight, Marcus had shared with us three pre-event materials. I hope you've had a chance to look at them. They really are quite terrific. Lots of information and an update on what's happening, what are the priorities now. So those are the two articles from McKinsey as well as the World Economic Forum, as well as a link to Marcus's website, which has a lot of information and modules on there. And of course, we have the actual event, which will start in a few minutes after I introduce Marcus. And just to highlight post-event opportunities, the video and presentation, which will be on our website, as well as our wanting to get feedback from you. There's a SurveyMonkey evaluation, which we request that you complete after the webinar. Okay, very quickly, you can see the slide on today's objectives. And now, really, to the main event, which is the webinar with Marcus. So I'd like to just say a few words about Marcus before I turn over to him. It really is a privilege to have him here with us. We're actually taking advantage of his being one of the innovators at ADB's Skills Development Forum, which is ongoing. So he presented yesterday, and so since he's here in Manila, we wanted to take advantage of his being here. Just a few words on background. Marcus started in international finance with Goldman Sachs and Citibank before launching his consultancy. And Love to Work is his company, which is designed to change consciousness and workplace culture. And it provides education and training, shows why emotional intelligence, problem solving, and critical thinking are crucial for developing the world at work. He also leads a number of social impactful community projects focusing on the youth. And as you may know, if you just Google Marcus, he's an international speaker and mentor to who's who of leaders, whether in politics, business, show business, or sport. And he comments, writes regularly for The Times, The Daily Mirror, London Evening Standard, as well as appears on BBC Radio London and London Live. So really, without further ado, I'd like to turn over to Marcus, who'll lead this webinar. Marcus, please.
Thank you very much, and good morning or good afternoon to everyone. First of all, I'm very honored to be here. I'm actually married to a Filipino, so every time I come here, I find tremendous love and a tremendous excitement from everyone. And secondly, to Victor, who for me is a very inspirational leader himself. And thank you for inviting me. So we have an hour and a quarter together. And in that time, I think different to many classes, which are perhaps more tangible with people in front of me, I would like to do about 15 or 20 minutes to set up this concept, because I think it's a little bit different for you. And then we'll do a workshop together halfway through, And at any point, feel free to question or send in questions. I like interaction, especially something disruptive. I think that's always healthy. And then to finish with, we'll conclude. There are certain points that I wish to leave you, so that if we never see each other again, you really have, I hope, 3 or 4 tools that can change your life quite dramatically, I think. So first of all, I want to tell you who we are, who Love to Work is. It's a UK-based operation, even though we do work globally. And it literally works on a few paradigms. It's leadership content that we teach, educate, and empower people. But it is particularly around emotional intelligence, around values-based leadership, and around purpose-driven success. And this is a tremendously novel thing in the West, and it's a tremendously important thing in the rest of the world. Because what it does is it gets underneath your skin. It won't give you headlines, it won't give you snapshots, and it won't give you the kind of terms that each one of us know that we should be or could be. It really does annoy you. It can wind you up. It can frustrate you because it actually will provoke change. So my job in the next hour will just be to provoke you to think. And that might be sounding a little silly, but really, I don't think we think that often. I think very often we're in this routine of work or of life, and we've forgotten how to think and how to awaken perhaps the original desire and value with which we came to work. So if we get this right, just to give you a big picture, first of all, if we really, really get this right, this kind of work multiplied by you and many of your peers is really quite realistically able to change the world. In a very literal sense, if enough people go through this transformation themselves, you will inspire your teams, you will inspire your families, you'll inspire your peer groups, you'll inspire and change, and it will inspire other people progressively, like a domino effect. And if you break down everything of a major world chaos right now, be it poverty, be it developing countries, GDP, overpopulation, wars and extremism, gender equality, child mortality, contribution, the pension state, all sorts of issues. If you break down those very macro issues, you come down to 2 simple facts, education and empowerment. And so what we do, Love to Work, is we literally go into various places, top to bottom, and we educate and empower individuals, be it school kids or be it CEOs, and we empower them with this very profound and quite novel view of leadership. So that's the big picture. Let's get to the meat of this morning as well. And for that, there are 3 questions that I have for you. 3 questions that I have for you. The first question is this. What if nothing is by coincidence? What if nothing in the world ever has been by coincidence? What if literally what you're doing now is not by coincidence? What you experienced this morning is not by coincidence? What you experienced yesterday wasn't by coincidence? What you experienced in your childhood, be it the difficulties, the challenges, the pain, the miracles, what if nothing you ever experienced was actually by coincidence? What if everything that you've ever experienced has been for something? Now again, this doesn't venture into the world of is nothing by coincidence. We're not going there. But what if you could choose, just from an empowering decision place, to say to every single situation, this is not by coincidence. This is in my movie for a reason. This is perhaps in my movie again for a reason. So what would that reason be? If you could choose every single second to actually decide that nothing is by coincidence, that nothing is random, that nothing has ever happened to you accidentally, that nothing has ever happened to you that is wrong or unjust or unfair, which is, again, a very far cry from most of our reactions most of our day, which is why, as leaders, we're mostly reactive. We're mostly effects of things. We're effects of teams. We're effects of... What if literally every single thing has happened to you because it is for place to be, because ultimately you've diminished yourself and your job will outgrow you. If you want to outgrow your job, which means your leadership wants to take yourself, your life, to the next level, you've got to be ahead of the game. What's the game? Well, this is the game is life. What's life? Well, life is showing you every single second what to be inspired from. It's not that you just need to be inspired from the job spec that you've been given by your boss or your employment contract. That's very rarely inspiring. You have to love what you do. If you don't love what you do, you're never going to contribute. What you contribute will be empty tasks, not value. You have to love what you do. If you love what you do, giving is easy. Adding is easy. Adding value is natural. So you've got to get yourself there. So the question is, how do you love what you do if you don't love what you do? So these are some of the concepts that we'll talk about today. But the first point is this: accept that nothing is by coincidence. If nothing's by coincidence, the second point is, you're not by coincidence. Again, the first point, nothing's by coincidence. The second point is, if nothing's by coincidence, then you're not by coincidence. And the question begs itself, then, what is the point of you? What is the purpose of you? What is the value of you? And sometimes for some people, that's very tough to quantify. Sometimes actually your peers will have more of an insight into your value than yourself, which is also an issue. Because if you're not sure of your value, what are you giving every day? What are you adding every day? What are you inspiring others with every day? Who are you? Not what is your job and what is your title and what respect you deserve. But the point is, again, if nothing's by coincidence, then what is the value of you? You're not by coincidence. And the assumption is, if you look at anything kind of scientific or life-oriented, most of those assumptions come down to the purpose is change, evolution, you could say. So the third point is this: if nothing is by coincidence, first point. Second point, if you're not by coincidence, and therefore here to change. The third point is, any place where you resist change is the enemy of your success. Think about it. Any place where you resist change becomes detrimental to your success. In fact, it's where you're rejecting success. In your head, you think to yourself, I wish to be a greater leader, I wish for more success. But actually, by virtue of your actions, which is really how we're measured, not my intentions, I'm measured according to my actions. My actions are saying, every day I'm contracting myself. Every day I'm diminishing myself. Every day I diminish my aura of leadership. Every day I diminish the influence of effective communication. Every day I diminish my team dynamic because actually I'm draining and sucking my energy out of the team. And so communications, effective leadership, team dynamics depends on me expanding myself, adding value from a deeper place. And that's what we're going to talk about today. But those three suppositions, those three questions are interesting to ask you, and we always start with those ideas. What if nothing's by coincidence, meaning you can draw value from every second? What if, therefore, you're not by coincidence, meaning that the value of you is inherent to loving what you do? And if you don't love what you do, you won't do it for long, or you won't do it well. And the third is, therefore, where you resist change becomes detrimental to your leadership. Where you resist change becomes detrimental, becomes diminishing to your leadership. It will literally reject effective leadership. Now, that's the first kind of section, if you like, those three points. The second section, which I would like to address, comes down as a result of that third point, which is, where are you rejecting change? Where are you rejecting growth? Where are you rejecting value? Now, that point, and it really is a chartable point, and you can map this, by the way, that point is called ego. Ego has many psychological meanings, has many other meanings, but the way that I would like to describe it is really that point, chartable point, at which pressure takes you down the wrong path. In other words, every one of us can handle things until. Every one of us tolerates people until. Every one of us enjoys experience until. Every one of us can love another person until. That point of until is the ego. Because that point of until, it creates literally a barrier around you. And that barrier is so integral and important to know. Because if you know that barrier, you know the effect of you. You know how far you cannot go and how far you've been. You know what is the influence of you as a leader, and you know where you are limited as a leader. And the point of life, and certainly the point of successful leadership, is to take that barrier and just to forever keep expanding it. To forever keep pushing that boundary. And that's a really interesting task. And so really the place I want to take you today is through a workshop that will take you to that point of knowing. You just can't get through to who you love being around and who you think is a pain to your team's efficiency, where you feel you can make tremendous effort with love and where you don't enjoy going, tasks that you feel you love to do and tasks that you feel you keep putting off. So all these points chart leadership boundaries, and literally, because we know that there are certain things that we love and certain things that we hate and certain people that we love and certain people that we don't like, so too, we stay within the bound of comfort. And we try and do as much as we can, but we... The first thing that they taught us was time management courses. And the first thing they taught us, I remember, was you do your A's first thing in the morning. Your A's they defined as all the critical tasks you probably don't want to do. And there are B tasks, which are kind of, you know, the more important tasks that you have more passion with, and the C tasks as the easiest tasks that you can do no-brainer. Most of us do the C's first because they just don't challenge us. They're easy to get through. And most of us then, unfortunately, have no time left for the A's. It's just a sad fact that every day has been too busy, and hey, I'll do it tomorrow. But when I come in tomorrow, I've been a bit groggy, I've not had my Starbucks. What does it mean? It means that I'm staying within the boundary of being an effective worker or an effective leader. Doing things that are uncomfortable is the only things that grow us and our organizations. Confronting people is painful but necessary, unless you are a natural confronter and an aggressive person, in which case your boundary is to actually be civil, is to perhaps let go, is to perhaps allow, in which case you have to stay outside of your boundary, which to be more placatory, more empowering, less directive. So we'll talk about these things. But the ego is the key. The ego is the key. One of the things that I think we do very well third idea, just before, the last point before the workshop, is to understand the effects of the ego and the effects of not overcoming your ego in effective leadership. The effects are you will attract more challenges to you. Interesting idea. Because the point of view, as we said, not by coincidence, is to change. And if you're not changing, the universe will allow you to change, insist you to change. It'll permit you to change in other ways. If you're running away from something that you have to do, life will show you in five other instances what you need to do. And it'll be much tougher tomorrow than it is today. So one of the most important concepts in the workshop that we do is to understand its importance. It's difficult, it's challenging, but it's far easier to get it right proactively than to get it wrong reactively and have to get taught the lesson and learn tomorrow, even in tougher ways. So tremendously important. We call that business karma, because it really is how challenges can repeat and overwhelm and grow as we miss where we're supposed to change, miss the points where we're supposed to change. And we'll talk about that with various examples of leadership as well, because I think to some degree, all of us have an idea where we are ineffective or effective leaders. I think some people know relationship or your friends outside of work can tell you your issues at work far more than you'll see at work, because when you're in work, you're blinkered. You're in it. You can't see. Right? So if your spouse, partner, boyfriend, girlfriend, husband or wife And the first point is, I think, pretty simple, is to identify where a leadership challenge is. And again, it could be something which is very obvious, very macro-oriented. I'm trying to lead a team to this particular organizational outcome, and it's very difficult because of market circumstances or otherwise. It could be something more personal. I think the more personal things are the more real things. I think when you tackle personal things, organizational things take care of themselves. I think actually organizations cannot change, only people do. So I think to get into that slightly deeper mode is important, very important. So identify where you feel challenged as a leader. And I'm guessing that you know, you can do this if you want, by yourself, so it's very honest, right? It might be that the people that you're with in your team or you're listening to are the very issues that you have a challenge with and through. So make it honest, make it very real. What is or what are the issues that you feel as a leader that you cannot abide by, you cannot tolerate, you can't understand, you can't go there, insecurities, fears, behavioral traits, direction, you think everyone should be listening to you because that's how you were taught to be a great person, and so you think the world needs to listen to you because that system repeats itself. Well, find out where you feel that you have a challenge in leadership and write that down. It's important to write these things down. I think mentally we think we can remember everything, and then an hour later we've forgotten everything. So write down where you feel that you have a challenge in leadership. Second point, and this is where we want to get under the surface. If we don't scratch the surface, nothing beyond that ego boundary can move. So what are your internal reactions to that external challenge? What are your internal reactions to that external challenge? Where do you go internally? Before you do anything, where do you go internally? You go to a place of insecurity. You go to a place of disrespect. You go to a place of anger. You go to a place of jealousy. You go to a place of blaming the world for your issues. You go to a place of frustration. You're at a place of defocused. Whatever it may be, find out where and ask yourself, where do you go inside? And by the way, most of us are so quick in challenges to react. We don't give ourselves a chance to really breathe, heal, learn, adapt, and grow. So just give yourself the chance to do that right now. Because the second this is over, probably you got to run to do more things. Where do you go internally? What are the emotional reactions internally? And the third is, what's the outcome? What's the outcome? So John yesterday humiliated me in a staff meeting. Internal reaction, I was tremendously embarrassed. I feel humiliated. I now hate him, and I feel a bit different with my work colleagues. What's the outcome? I'm a bit withdrawn today. I'm a bit withdrawn today. Right? So what are the challenges, the emotional reactions, and the outcomes? Now, most of us jump from stage 1 to 3. There's a challenge, and we just have this survival mode, and our survival gene just jumps us to a place of protection. But these are the three points I would like you to write down. So again, just to give you another few seconds to write these down, the leadership challenge, what is the challenge you feel that threatens your leadership, that pushes your leadership, that blocks you as an effective leader? Where do you go inside, which is the most important, clearly? And thirdly, what is the outcome? How do you react? What is the pushback with that challenge? How do you cope with that challenge? Okay? We want to get to a place which is a proactive formula. But before we get there, I think it would be valuable to just share amongst you what you've written. Because I think once you start to open the gate, especially in regard to that second category, you'll be amazing what clarity can come to you. Because really, all the power is within. All the clarity is within. All the intuition is within. So when you give some energy to that level of you as a deeper, effective leader, something universally helps you. Remember this. There are many people who somehow, as leaders, they have something within. They have something magical within them. And you can notice it. You can feel it. You can lift yourself with it. It's that internal clarity and power and stability and rooted energy that you train yourself. That's a muscle. That's what we do. We train that muscle. So what you say goes further. What you think goes further. What you do goes further because you're bigger. Okay? So just share with the person next to you for the next 30 seconds or so, next minute each maybe, what you wrote down in that exercise. One note of warning is if you, as your challenge, wrote the person who is sitting next to you, change their name to someone who they don't know, so they think that you're talking about someone random. We wouldn't want to cause any more disruptions. Okay? So give yourself 1 minute and share each in perhaps a 4 or a 3 or a 2 what your challenge was. We'll give you a couple of minutes. So let's go back now to these 3 points. Again, 1 was challenge, 2 was internal reaction, and 3 was outcome. We're trying to change outcomes here. We're trying to change the outcomes of how effective you are as a leader and how your leadership is creating more effectivity, more productivity, more profitability, more whatever your goals are in leadership. All those key performance indicators should change based on us using this proactive formula. So it's not just to become a better person or to become a self-help individual. Self-help for me is very superficial. This is literally about transforming something inside so everything outside corresponds. The only way anything can ever change outside is when something inside first changes. It makes sense. So the first point is this. It looks like that you are, and perhaps we'll go back, it looks like that you are reacting to the person or the challenge. So whatever you wrote, first of all, about a person or a situation or a repetitive experience, it looks like that you're reacting to that person. But what we need to know, and this is the first point, is that you have never reacted to anyone ever before, nor will you ever react to anyone else ever before. You have only ever reacted to yourself. That looks like the person in front of you is the one who you're reacting to. It looks like the person in front of you is the one who you're feeling very angry towards. But what you're reacting to is not the person. What you're reacting to is the anger. It looks like the person in front of you is creating this insecurity. What you're reacting to is not the person. What you're reacting to is the insecurity. It looks like the challenge in front of you is giving you tremendous judgment on others. What you're reacting to is not the challenge. What you're reacting to is your judgment. It looks like the team in front of you don't allow you to do what you feel you're capable of doing. And that creates you to feel a sense of jealousy because other people you know are more successful. What you're reacting to is not the team. What you're reacting to is your jealousy. And so what we're saying is that you've never reacted to teams or people or challenges because no one does. What you react to is your judgment, your jealousy, your insecurity, your fears, your arrogance. What you're reacting to is just what you wrote as your second answer. What creates you to be effective or ineffective as a leader is not based on your first answer of challenge. It is based on your second answer of your insides. What will change those challenges is attending to your insides. If you don't attend to that repetitive fear coming up, you will never remove the people making you fearful. And so you can run away all you want, but you never change the issue of people coming at you with fear. Because fear is inside of you and you can't run away from yourself. So effective leadership needs to be more internal. If you get what's internal right, what's external is clear and easy and manageable. And you'll handle challenges. And in fact, those challenges you'll enjoy. The challenge right now is that the leadership person or thing or event annoys you. If you understand all you're supposed to change is your annoyance and you feel passion in changing how easily you're annoyed and you feel empowered by elevating yourself based on changing how easily someone else can push your buttons, if that is empowering you, grows you, excites you, the person who's giving you that sense of change, you'll be excited by. Now they've turned from not being an annoyance, now they become your best friend because you can see the change they give you. And you might not befriend them physically, but the experience you can love. And that's the key. You can love the experience, and if you can love the experience, you can tolerate them. And suddenly, human dignity is a baseline. You haven't got to love some, reward some, and hate and secretly send negative daggers to others. You have that baseline of dignity to everyone. And there's very few leaders, unfortunately, around the world that have that baseline of consistent and unequivocal human dignity. In fact, if anything, I would say we suffer from a crisis of leadership all over the world because there are very few exemplary leaders who live their lives in a way they manage teams. There's work and there's, I'm home now. I haven't got to be the person at work, or vice versa. There's very few people around the world who first of all think about changing the world for the better as opposed to just job outcomes, and who live their lives in an exemplary fashion. But imagine this. Imagine if you as a leader could embrace now what's blocking you, because that ego is what you wrote in point two. The points that you wrote in point two represent the boundary of ineffective versus effective leadership. The difference between your effective or ineffective leadership is whether you will be victim to your fear or whether you'll transcend and overcome it. The difference between you as an effective or ineffective leader will be whether you can communicate with that person or whether you will sideline them because you disagree with them. The difference between effective and ineffective leadership will be whether you can overcome your blame of others or not. So you as an effective leader will not be effective. and effective leadership and critical path communication and critical thinking and creativity and people management and all those clever strap lines that we can all be taught. I've been taught them for the last 15 years. I was taught them in banking 20 years ago, and still those same banks don't espouse those same values. They taught me, but they didn't ethically represent those values. They were molding me without becoming or being that themselves. How to be that? You have to be that. How do you become that effective leader? Forget the strap lines and become the person. Take that boundary of your ego called your internal reactions. Look at where everyone winds you up. Look where everyone frustrates you. Look at where the world is pushing your buttons. Chart it. Look at all your reactions, because that chart is the boundary of your ego. That's what's killing you. It's not the person next to you. Your ego has and is and always will be the only enemy that you'll ever have in your life. Inspire and pat him on the back and give him a good smile. But you know inside it's not real. What's real is one of two things: soul or ego. Ego meaning all the debilitating attitudes, beliefs, and behaviors that each of us have. And soul being the true talent that uniquely every person has to somehow find to give to society. Even though the words ego and soul are used in many, many contexts, I don't go there. Soul and ego are edgy because we as people need to be edgy. We need to be edgy. We need to be disruptive. We need to be disruptive. I say that in a very traditional organization with some fear, but I think it needs us to develop. It is called the Asian Development Bank. I'm sure part of it is not just to develop the outside world. I think part of it must be to develop ourselves inside if we're ever to do anything effective outside. Interesting idea. But the point is, if you can't chart the boundary of your ego, you're lost in your ego, and you'll never be more than you are today or yesterday. And that's depressing, I hope. And I hope I you, wherever and whoever you are. So I want to go through now, just to finish, a formula that I hope you can go home with, and I hope that you can use. It is quite practical, meaning that as the situation or obstacle appears, you're going to be able to think to yourself, I've got to employ this proactive formula. So it's good in a situation where you're reacting to others, but it's also effective in a situation where you want to be more strategic about life and how to become more effective leader in anything that you do. The first step sounds a bit silly, but most of us can't get past it. When someone or something happens, pause. Pause. Just stop. Breathe. Just wait. I know the ego will give you a survival mechanism of 40 strategic answers right now, all of which fires down, shoots down any enemy, and pushes every boundary so you can stay comfortable back in your ego. You want to disengage that. You got to disengage your ego, because your ego is that survival part of you. It's a coping mechanism. And you want to disengage it. It's the first thing that's going to fire up when someone challenges. The first thought when someone says, "You look awful today," is... Or the first thought when someone says, "I got your report last week and it was really not standard, it was substandard." Or the first thought when someone says to you, "I just don't agree with what you're doing," is normally, well, you know, forget you, right? I mean, who the hell are you? Have you looked inside yourself recently? I saw some class on some effective leadership, and they said you have to look inside, and you're not looking inside. Well, you're not looking inside either by saying that, right? That's why most of us as teachers in Love to Work, we'll spend more of every day studying and learning and doing our work than teaching. And we teach a lot. Because unless you're being it, you can't teach it. You haven't got the right to teach it. That's the concept. I hope we're true to that. So the first stage is pause. Shut up. Stop. Breathe. You know, I'm sure each of us has written an email in response to someone attacking us that a day later we thought, "Oh, I shouldn't have written that." you say something back that an hour later you thought, "I would have phrased that a bit different." Difficult to do. The next two stages are difficult to understand, but maybe easier. Maybe easier. Not even sure about that. Let's see. The next stage is own. Own. Meaning, you've got to own what's just happened. If you can't own what's just happened, you will have no power from it. You've got to be able to say, "Why is this in my movie? Why is this happening to me? What is it about my reaction or my leadership or my sick circumstance that has attracted this? Why on earth would this happen to me? Nothing is by coincidence. So why would this be in my movie? I'm not by coincidence. So what is this doing to evolve me?" And the resistance to change is the enemy of success. So therefore, the enemy is not you, it's my reaction to you right now. So I've got to own that reaction. I've got to own that ego. I've got to start to see, wow, this is my ego. Wow, it's screaming. Wow, I really want to shout back at you right now. Wow, if I had a gun, I would shoot you right now. Why? All these reactions that we kind of, you know, think and go far too far with. Effective your leadership can be by changing that part of your ego. I hope this makes sense. So own, become aware, not the enemy of the person, the enemy of the ego. And realize the situation is coming from within. It's actually something that you need. It's something coming from within your guts that needs this part of your ego to get out of your life or needs some talent to be exposed to you. Most people's talent come from pressure. You want to make a diamond? You need thousands of pounds of pressure every moment for a long time. Talent is extracted from pressure. If you're running from pressure, which is what immediate response, coping mechanism, overreaction, underreaction, overaggressive, suppressed, passive aggressive, means you're not embracing the change that life's giving you. You're actually diminishing your life, you're diminishing your job, you're diminishing your effective communication, leadership, and productivity. And the last part is turn your reaction around. Turn your reaction around, meaning you take your reaction, anger, and you find a way to turn it around. Now that's difficult. That is why we teach courses and classes and many, many sessions on this, because actually to own it is a course, to turn it is another course. But just briefly, where you feel fear of something, you have to know that it's not true, really, usually what you're feeling. What you're feeling is a projected thought as to what might happen in a day, week, month. And that pain comes back to you and contracts your view objectively of the situation right now. It's not real. When you feel anger, there's something else going on there. It's normally an entitlement that you feel of something. When you feel insecurity, you're not feeling how you're supposed to affect and express yourself and your value and your talent. You're not expressing yourself elsewhere enough. When you feel judgment, you're not taking enough responsibility inside of you. You're pointing always at something outside because you feel probably a tremendous sense of self-judgment inside that you're not dealing with, hence why you keep judging others. So with every single reaction, there's an antidote. And if you can turn that around, you feel empowered, you feel channeled, you feel an energy, you feel a security, you feel that the world is your oyster, and then do something with that challenge. Be proactive. Express yourself in a way which is different to the reactive expression. Express yourself. Don't suppress it. Share. Is the first three questions. Nothing's by coincidence. You're not by coincidence. And then the enemy of success is resistance to that change. The second category is about charting, therefore, the boundary of ego as to whether you're within or without your comfort zone. And the third concept is how to pause, how to own, and turn around every situation to ensure that you become a very effective leader. Now, I would just add that there is a theory in life that what makes you happier is to do more pot. Right? There's a theory in life that what makes a person happier in life is to do more pot. I'm not sure if you've heard that theory. Right? People have said that by doing pot, person becomes happier, right? What I think they're talking about is POT, pausing, owning, and turning. I'm not sure what you were thinking of just now, but definitely the real proactive formula is doing more pot. What does that mean? It means to pause, to own, and to turn around that situation. And you therefore or perhaps not. So definitely on that basis, I hope you understand those 3 points about nothing's by coincidence, you're not by coincidence, resistance to success is the enemy of change, or the enemy of success is resistance to change, same actual concept. Secondly, the boundary of your ego. To chart that is the most important thing in life. And the third thing is, and that's probably what I will leave you with, is try and do a lot more pot at work, please. Thank you very much for being with us, or for listening afterwards, or for being here, and good afternoon.
Okay, thanks very much, Marcus. We do have a few minutes in case anybody would like to ask Marcus a question, ask about a challenge that he or she is dealing with, or anybody wants to share a reaction to what Marcus was saying, which is all very, very big picture, I think, really of the essence lessons. You want to also hear Manila?
Good morning.
Yes, please. Good morning.
I'm Manil Motwani from the India Resident Mission, and Marcus, quite an interesting diminish yourself in your views and let the other person prevail.
Mediative techniques alone. Sometimes they're very effective, but I think very often they cover up issues. It's like peace negotiations. If you create a piece of paper that is a negotiated ambassadorial piece of paper, you neglect the hatred that lives in the hearts and minds of the people, which means there's going to be another war somewhere, sometime down the line soon. So unless you can somehow deal with the emotional situation of that right and wrong, there's no mediation that can just patch the issue. So that said, I have a proactive formula for you to start with. I found, and by the way, I could give you, were I not bound to various confidentiality agreements, I could give you many situations where you might in the newspapers have read
of a successful event through various leaders that an hour before or a day before or a week before was complete carnage. And I've done this exercise many times, and it sounds annoying, and I apologize for that, but it is effective, and it works. The proactive formula is pause, take out the fact that they're wrong from your mind, first of all, because that's the ego, right? They might be wrong, genuinely, but the fact that they're wrong means your ego says that you're right, and that's the problem. When you think that you're solely right and they're solely wrong, that's the first problem. You have to own what's going on here. To own means you have to understand why this is in your movie, what is coming up, what reactions come up, like we said, and that's the first step. So the first reactions might be your judgment of it being so right and so wrong and so clear. And by the way, I'm sure they think the same on the other side. So to turn it around, I have an interesting suggestion for you. I want you to make a list of all the traits that they have at and they're at fault because of. So if there is a key player or a key person or a key member of the team, I want you to write down his or her issues, which I'm sure you're aware of. He's arrogant, he's judgmental, he's naive, he's not open to suggestion, he's a lone wolf, he's not a team player, and so on and so forth. And I want you to then look at the key players that you think are influencing that team and write down all their issues, which again, when we have issues with them, normally come very easily to us. And I want you to group those issues and find one, two, perhaps three themes. And I want you then to see those themes in you. For example, if you're saying that there's a theme, they are closed to anything outside of what they already know, I want you to disconnect from this situation and think, where in my life am I closed to an outside suggestion beyond something I know? And it might take you home. It might take you perhaps to your kids, where your son is trying to say, Dad, I want to do this. I want to pursue that as a career, as a hobby, as a whatever. And you're saying, son, that's not the way that we do things. It might be to your wife, who's saying, we need more balance. I need more of you. And you're saying, but I'm doing this for us. I'm working 20 hours a day for us. That is my example of sacrifice for us. And she's saying, it's not for me. And you're close to that thought, even unexpressed, that she's saying. Because if you can take their issues to that place and change in that level, you'll be amazed what they will change in your next conversation. And it sounds surreal, but it will do one of two things. It'll either remove that issue from them that's not by coincidence in your movie, or it'll render their issues immune to you such that you'll see a better solution to that necessary mediation. That might take a good few months to digest as well. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks so much.
Any other comments, questions? It's good to see you, Mr. Motwani.
Good morning, Penret from Kham. We've been, having this situation, and we try to follow this proactive formula previously. You know, we try to, take times to rethink our reaction, our feedback, something like that. And then we try to identify what would be the best strategies to deal with situation. And then we you try to again meet and talk, discuss the issue together, and try to solve the problem. At the end, we can have a good relationship, and we can, you know, create a better working environment. So we test this also, the formula. For me, I don't have a question, but just a suggestion. We might appreciate if you could share the presentation and also related reading materials so that we can have some more reference for reading. Thank you.
Thank you. And it's again, it's good to see you there. I would add that it's very encouraging that it kind of gels with you. And to suggest also that it's really a constant deepening stream, in that it's not a flat formula that can just plug and play. It's something which every single day and every single month can become deeper and more embedded into practice. And that said, it will turn from being just a strategic, objective, unemotional analysis and effective communication to becoming actually very evocative. So it's not just strategically external and effective, it's actually me learning more of my personal leadership traits and my ego traits that allow me to be a better leader. So it's taking that strategy and it's constantly deepening my awareness and understanding of what's inside of me that's feeding that strategy. That's where it can go, and if it goes there, it can deepen forever, and if it deepens forever, you'll become more effective forever.